This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Republican Party, also commonly called the GOP for Grand Old Party, is one of the world's oldest extant political parties. It is the second oldest existing political party in the United States after its primary rival, the Democratic Party. It emerged in 1854 to combat the Kansas-Nebraska Act, which threatened to extend slavery into the territories, and to promote more vigorous modernization of the economy. The party had almost no presence in the South, but by 1858 in the North it had enlisted former Whigs and former Free Soil Democrats to form majorities in nearly every northern state with its election of Abraham Lincoln in 1860, and its success in guiding the Union to victory and abolishing slavery. The party came to dominate the national political scene until 1932. The Republican Party was based on northern white Protestants, businessmen, small business owners, professionals, factory workers, farmers, and African Americans. It was pro-business, supporting banks, the gold standard, railroads, and high tariffs to protect factory workers and grow industry faster under William McKinley and Theodore Roosevelt. It emphasized an expansive foreign policy. The GOP lost its majorities during the Great Depression 1929-1940. Instead, the Democrats under Franklin D. Roosevelt formed a winning New Deal coalition, which was dominant from 1932 through 1964. That coalition collapsed in the mid-1960s, partly because of white Southern Democrats' disaffection with passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964. Republicans won 5 of the 6 presidential elections from 1968 to 1988, with Ronald Reagan as the party's iconic conservative hero from 1992 to 2016. The Republican candidate has been elected to the White House in 3 of the 7 presidential elections, and only in 1 out of those 7 elections, in 2004, did he win the popular vote. The GOP expanded its base throughout the South after 1968, excepting 1976, largely due to its strength among socially conservative white evangelical Protestants and traditionalist Roman Catholics, as white Democrats in the South lost dominance of the Democratic Party once U.S. courts declared the Democratic white primary elections unconstitutional. The region began more taking on the two-party apparatus which characterized most of the nation. The Republican Party's transforming leader by 1980 was Reagan, whose conservative policies called for reduced government spending and regulation, lower taxes, and a strong anti-Soviet foreign policy. His influence upon the party persists, as nearly every GOP speaker still reveres him. Social scientists Theodore Kaplow et al. Argue, the Republican Party, nationally, moved from right-center toward the center in the 1940s and 1950s, then moved right again in the 1970s and 1980s. Contents 1. Ideological beginnings. 2. Organizational beginnings. 1854. 3. Establishing a national party, an opposition. 4. The Civil War and Republican dominance, 1860-1896-41. Reconstruction, freedmen, carpetbaggers, and scalawags. 42. The Gilded Age, 1877-1890-43. Ethnocultural politics, pietistic Republicans versus liturgical Democrats. 5. The Progressive Era, 1896-1932-6. Progressives and liberals. 7. Political firsts for women and minorities. 8. Fighting the New Deal Coalition, 1932-1980-81-1933-1938-82-1939-1952-83. Eisenhower and Nixon, 1952-1974-84. Citizens for Eisenhower, 85. Nixon and Goldwater, 86. Moderate Republicans of 1960-1980-87. Realignment, the South becomes Republican. 871-1964-1972-8711. Southern Strategy. 9. Reagan to Bush, 1980-2008-91. The Reagan Revolution. 92. Congressional ascendancy in 1994-93. Neoconservatives. 94. The Second Bush Era. 10. Challenging the Obama Administration, 2009-2016-101-2012-2016-102. Demographic shifts since 2009-11. See also. 12 notes. 13 footnotes. 14 references. 141 surveys. 1411-1854-1932-1412. Since 1932-142. Primary sources. Ideological beginnings. See also, Third Party System. The Republican Party began as a coalition of anti-slavery conscience Whigs and Free Soil Democrats opposed to the Kansas-Nebraska Act, submitted to Congress by Stephen Douglas in January 1854. The act opened Kansas Territory and Nebraska Territory to slavery and future admission as slave states, thus implicitly repealing the prohibition on slavery in territory north of 36 degrees 30 latitude, which had been part of the Missouri Compromise. This change was viewed by Free Soil and abolitionist Northerners as an aggressive, expansionist maneuver by the slave-owning South. The act was supported by all Southerners, by Northern doughface pro-Southern Democrats and by other Northern Democrats persuaded by Douglas's doctrine of popular sovereignty. In the North, the old Whig Party was almost defunct. The opponents were intensely motivated and began forming a new party. The new party went well beyond the issue of slavery in the territories. It envisioned modernizing the United States, emphasizing giving free Western land to farmers, free soil, as opposed to letting slave owners buy up the best lands, expanded banking, more railroads, and factories. They vigorously argued that free market labor was superior to slavery and the very foundation of civic virtue and true republicanism. This was the free soil, free labor, free men ideology. The Republicans absorbed the previous traditions of its members, most of whom had been Whigs, others had been Democrats or members of third parties, especially the Free Soil Party and the American Party, also known as the Know Nothings. Many Democrats who joined were rewarded with governorships, or seats in the U.S. Senate, or House of Representatives. Note 3. Since its inception, its chief opposition has been the Democratic Party, but the amount of flow back and forth of prominent politicians between the two parties was quite high from 1854 to 1896. Historians have explored the ethnocultural foundations of the party, along the line that ethnic and religious groups set the moral standards for their members, who then carried those standards into politics. The churches also provided social networks that politicians used to sign up voters. The pietistic churches emphasized the duty of the Christian to purge sin from society. Sin took many forms. Alcoholism, polygamy, and slavery became special targets for the Republicans. The Yankees, who dominated New England, much of upstate New York, and much of the upper Midwest, were the strongest supporters of the new party. This was especially true for the pietistic Congregationalists and Presbyterians among them, and during the war, the Methodists, along with Scandinavian Lutherans. The Quakers were a small tight-knit group that was heavily Republican. The liturgical churches, Roman Catholic, Episcopal, German Lutheran, by contrast, largely rejected the moralism of the Republican Party. Most of their adherents voted Democratic. The early standard bearers of the party expressed views of government that marked the first years of its existence. For instance, William H. Seward, New York governor who ran vied with Lincoln for the nomination in 1860, had called for welcoming immigrants with all the sympathy that their misfortunes at home, their condition as strangers here, and their devotion to liberty, ought to excite. And Lincoln, in his 1861 message to Congress, argued that the essential reason for preserving the central government was to maintain, in the world, that form and substance of government, whose leading object is to elevate the condition of men. Opposed to the expansion of slavery into new territories and selected a statewide slate of candidates. The Midwest took the lead in forming state party tickets, while the eastern states lagged a year or so. There were no efforts to organize the party in the South, apart from St. Louis and a few areas adjacent to free states. The party initially had its base in the Northeast and Midwest. This Democratic editorial cartoon links Fremont to other radical movements, including temperance, feminism, Fourierism, free love, Catholicism, and abolition. Establishing a national party and opposition. The party launched its first national convention in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, on February 22, 1856, with its first national nominating convention held in the summer in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, presided by Francis Preston Blair Sr. John C. Fremont ran as the first Republican nominee for president in 1856 behind the slogan, "Free Soil, Free Silver, Free Men, Fremont and Victory." Although Fremont's bid was unsuccessful, the party showed a strong base. It dominated in New England, New York, and the northern Midwest, and had a strong presence in the rest of the North. It had almost no support in the South, where it was roundly denounced in 1856-1860 as a divisive force that threatened civil war. Without using the term containment, the new party in the mid-1850s proposed a system of Containing slavery, once it gained control of the national government. Historian James Oakes explains the strategy. The federal government would surround the South with free states, free territories, and free waters, building what they called a cordon of freedom around slavery, hemming it in until the system's own internal weaknesses forced the slave states one by one to abandon slavery. Leading up to the second presidential election after the party's establishment, disdain for it grew considerably among Democrats, particularly those from the South. In reference to the Republicans' anti-slavery position, prominent Democrats applied the slur "Black Republican" against them, as seen repeatedly in the speeches of Senator Stephen Douglas during the Lincoln-Douglas debates of 1858 in Illinois during the presidential campaign in 1860. At a time of escalating tension between the North and South, Abraham Lincoln addressed the harsh treatment of Republicans in the South in his famous Cooper Union speech, "Hen, you speak of us Republicans, you do so only to denounce us as reptiles, or, at the best, as no better than outlaws. You will grant a hearing to pirates or murderers, but nothing like it to black Republicans. But you will not abide the election of a Republican president. In that supposed event, you say, you will destroy the Union, and then, you say, the great crime of having destroyed it will be upon us. That is cool." A highwayman holds a pistol to my ear, and mutters through his teeth, "Stand and deliver, or I shall kill you, and then you will be a murderer." The Civil War and Republican Dominance, 1860-1896, Union Ticket in 1864, party men gave these to voters to deposit in the ballot box. The election of Lincoln in 1860 opened a new era of Republican dominance based in the industrial North and agricultural Midwest. The third party system was dominated by the Republican Party. It lost the presidency only in 1884 and 1892. Lincoln proved brilliantly successful in uniting the factions of his party to fight for the Union. However, he usually fought the radical Republicans who demanded harsher measures. Most Democrats at first were war Democrats, and supportive until the fall of 1862 when Lincoln added the abolition of slavery as a war goal. Many war Democrats became peace Democrats. Most of the state Republican parties accepted the anti-slavery goal except Kentucky. In Congress, the party passed major legislation to promote rapid modernization, including a national banking system, high tariffs, the first temporary income tax, many excise taxes, paper money issued without backing, greenbacks, a huge national debt, homestead laws, railroads, and aid to education and agriculture. The Republicans denounced the peace-oriented Democrats as disloyal copperheads and won enough war Democrats to maintain their majority in 1862. In 1864, they formed a coalition with many war Democrats as the National Union Party, which re-elected Lincoln easily during the war. Upper-middle-class men in major cities formed union leagues to promote and help finance the war effort. First colored senator and representatives, Sen. Hiram Revels RMS, Rep. Benjamin Turner RL, Robert DeLarge RSC, Josiah Walls RFL, Jefferson Long RGAW, Joseph Rainey and Robert B. Elliott RSC, 1872 Reconstruction, Freedmen, Carpetbaggers, and Scalawags. In Reconstruction, how to deal with the ex-Confederates and the freed slaves, or freedmen, were the major issues by 1864. Radical Republicans controlled Congress and demanded more aggressive action against slavery, and more vengeance toward the Confederates. Lincoln held them off, but just barely. Republicans at first welcomed President Andrew Johnson. The radicals thought he was one of them and would take a hard line in punishing the South. Johnson, however, broke with them and formed a loose alliance with moderate Republicans and Democrats. The showdown came in the congressional elections of 1866, in which the radicals won a sweeping victory and took full control of Reconstruction, passing key laws over the veto. Johnson was impeached by the House, but acquitted by the Senate. Ulysses S. Grant was the first Republican president to serve for two full terms, 1869-1877. With the election of Ulysses S. Grant in 1868, the radicals had control of Congress, the party and the army, and attempted to build a solid Republican base in the South using the votes of freedmen, scalawags and carpetbaggers, supported directly by U.S. Army detachments. Republicans all across the South formed local clubs called Union Leagues that effectively mobilized the voters, discussed issues, and when necessary fought off Ku Klux Klan KKK attacks. Thousands died on both sides. Grant supported radical Reconstruction programs in the South, the 14th Amendment, and equal civil and voting rights for the freedmen. then most of all he was the hero of the war veterans, who marched to his tune. The party had become so large that factionalism was inevitable. It was hastened by Grant's tolerance of high levels of corruption typified by the whiskey ring. Many of the founders of the GOP joined the liberal movement, as did many powerful newspaper editors. They nominated Horace Greeley for president, who also gained the Democratic nomination, but the ticket was defeated in a landslide. The Depression of 1873 energized the Democrats. They won control of the House and formed Redeemer coalitions, which recaptured control of each Southern state, in some cases using threats and violence. Reconstruction came to an end when the contested election of 1876 was awarded by a special electoral commission to Republican Rutherford B. Hayes, who promised, through the unofficial compromise of 1877, to withdraw federal troops from control of the last three Southern states. The region then became the Solid South, giving overwhelming majorities of its electoral votes and congressional seats to the Democrats through 1964. In terms of racial issues, Sarah Woolfolk Wiggins argues that in Alabama, white Republicans as well as Democrats solicited black votes but reluctantly rewarded blacks with nominations for office only when necessary, even then reserving the more choice positions for whites. The results were predictable. These half-a-loaf gestures satisfied neither black nor white Republicans. The fatal weakness of the Republican Party in Alabama, as elsewhere in the South, was its inability to create a biracial political party, and while in power even briefly, they failed to protect their members from Democratic terror. Alabama Republicans were forever on the defensive. Verbally and physically, social pressure eventually forced most scalawags to join the conservative Democratic Redeemer coalition. A minority persisted and formed the tan half of the black and tan Republican Party, a minority in every Southern state after 1877 in several Southern states. The lily whites, who sought to recruit white Democrats to the Republican Party, attempted to purge the black and tan faction, or at least to reduce its influence among such lily white leaders in the early 20th century. Arkansas's Wallace Townsend was the party's gubernatorial nominee in 1916 and 1920, and its veteran national GOP committeeman. Starting in the 1870s, Southern Republicans were divided into two factions, the lily white faction, which was practically all white, and the biracial black and tan faction. The factionalism flared up in 1928 and 1952. The final victory of its opponent, the lily white faction, came in 1964. The Gilded Age, 1877 to 1890. The GOP, short for Grand Old Party, as it was now nicknamed, split into factions in the late 1870s. The stalwarts, followers of Senator Roscoe Conkling, defended the spoils system. The half-breeds, who followed Senator James G. Blaine of Maine, pushed for reform of the civil service. Independents, who opposed the spoils system altogether, were called mugwumps. In 1884, mugwumps rejected James G. Blaine as corrupt and helped elect Democrat Grover Cleveland. Most returned to the party by 1888 as the northern post-war economy boomed with industry, railroads, mines, and fast-growing cities, as well as prosperous agriculture. The Republicans took credit and promoted policies to keep the fast growth going. The Democratic Party was largely controlled by pro-business Bourbon Democrats until 1896. The GOP supported big business generally, the gold standard, high tariffs, and generous pensions for Union veterans by 1890. However, the Republicans had agreed to the Sherman Antitrust Act and the Interstate Commerce Commission in response to complaints from owners of small businesses and farmers. The high McKinley tariff of 1890 hurt the party, and the Democrats swept to a landslide in the off-year elections, even defeating McKinley himself. Foreign affairs seldom became partisan issues except for the annexation of Hawaii, which Republicans favored and Democrats opposed. Much more salient were cultural issues. The GOP supported the Pietistic Protestants, especially the Methodists, Congregationalists, Presbyterians, and Scandinavian Lutherans, who demanded prohibition that angered wet Republicans, especially German Americans, who broke ranks in 1890-1892, handing power to the Democrats. Demographic trends aided the Democrats, as the German and Irish Catholic immigrants were mostly Democrats, and outnumbered the British and Scandinavian Republicans during the 1880s. Elections were remarkably close. The Democrats usually lost, but won in 1884 and 1892. In the 1894 congressional elections, the GOP scored the biggest landslide in its history, as Democrats were blamed for the severe economic depression 1893-1897 and the violent coal and railroad strikes of 1894. Ethnocultural politics, Pietistic Republicans versus liturgical Democrats. Voting behavior by religion, Northern U.S. late 19th century. 45-55 English Canadians 40-60 British Stock 35-65 German Sectarians 30-70 Norwegian Lutherans 20-80 Swedish Lutherans 15-85 Hagian Norwegians 595 Natives, Northern Stock Quakers 595 Free Will Baptists 2080 Congregational 2575 Methodists 2575 Regular Baptists 3565 Blacks 4060 Presbyterians 4060 Episcopalians 4555 Natives, Southern Stock Living in North Disciples 5050 Presbyterians 7030 Baptists 75 25 Methodists 9010 from 1860 to 1912, the Republicans took advantage of the association of the Democrats with rum, Romanism, and rebellion. Rum stood for the liquor interests and the tavernkeepers, in contrast to the GOP, which had a strong dry element. Romanism meant Roman Catholics, especially Irish Americans, who ran the Democratic Party in every big city, and whom the Republicans denounced for political corruption. Rebellion stood for the Democrats of the Confederacy, who tried to break the Union in 1861. And the Democrats in the North, called Copperheads, who sympathized with them. Demographic trends aided the Democrats, as the German and Irish Catholic immigrants were Democrats, and outnumbered the English and Scandinavian Republicans during the 1880s and 1890s. The Republicans struggled against the Democrats' efforts, winning several close elections and losing two to Grover Cleveland in 1884 and 1892. Religious lines were sharply drawn: Methodists, Congregationalists, Presbyterians, Scandinavian Lutherans, and other. Pietists in the North were tightly linked to the GOP in sharp contrast, liturgical groups, especially the Catholics, Episcopalians, and German Lutherans, looked to the Democratic Party for protection from Pietistic moralism, especially prohibition. Both parties cut across the class structure, with the Democrats more bottom-heavy. Cultural issues, especially prohibition and foreign language schools, became important because of the sharp religious divisions in the electorate in the North. About 50% of the voters were Pietistic Protestants, Methodists, Scandinavian Lutherans, Presbyterians, Congregationalists, Disciples of Christ who believed the government should be used to reduce social sins, such as drinking. Liturgical churches, Roman Catholics, German Lutherans, Episcopalians comprised over a quarter of the vote and wanted the government to stay out of the morality business. Prohibition debates and referendums heated up politics in most states over a period of decade, as national prohibition was finally passed in 1919 and repealed in 1933, serving as a major issue between the wet Democrats and the dry GOP. The Progressive Era, 1896-1932. See also, Fourth Party System. The election of William McKinley in 1896 is widely seen as a resurgence of Republican dominance and is cited as a realigning election. An 1896 GOP poster warns against free silver. The Progressive Era, or Fourth Party System, was dominated by Republican presidents, with the sole exception of Democrat Woodrow Wilson. 1913-1921 McKinley promised that high tariffs would end the severe hardship caused by the Panic of 1893, and that the GOP would guarantee a sort of pluralism in which all groups would benefit. He denounced William Jennings Bryan, the Democratic nominee, as a dangerous radical whose plans for free silver at 16-1 or bimetallism would bankrupt the economy. McKinley relied heavily on finance, railroads, industry, and the middle classes for his support and cemented the Republicans as the party of business. His campaign manager, Ohio's Mark Hanna, developed a detailed plan for getting contributions from the business world, and McKinley outspent his rival William Jennings Bryan by a large margin. This emphasis on business was in part mitigated by Theodore Roosevelt, the presidential successor after McKinley's assassination in 1901, who engaged in trust busting. McKinley was the first president to promote pluralism, arguing that prosperity would be shared by all ethnic and religious groups. Theodore Roosevelt, who became president in 1901, had the most dynamic personality of the era. Roosevelt had to contend with men like Senator Mark Hanna, whom he outmaneuvered to gain control of the convention in 1904 that renominated him, and he won after promising to continue McKinley's policies. More difficult to handle was conservative House Speaker Joseph Gurney Cannon. TR leads party to landslide win in 1904. Roosevelt achieved modest legislative gains in terms of railroad legislation and pure food laws. He was more successful in court, bringing antitrust suits that broke up the Northern Securities Company Trust and Standard Oil. Roosevelt moved left in his last 2 years in office but was unable to pass major square deal proposals. He did succeed in naming his successor Secretary of War William Howard Taft, who easily defeated Bryan again in the 1908 presidential election. President Teddy Roosevelt watches GOP team regime pull apart on tariff issue. The tariff issue was pulling the GOP apart. Roosevelt tried to postpone the issue, but Taft had to meet it head-on in 1909 with the Payne-Aldrich Tariff Act. Eastern conservatives led by Nelson W. Aldrich wanted high tariffs on manufactured goods, especially woolens, while Midwesterners called for low tariffs. Aldrich tricked them by lowering the tariff on farm products, which outraged the farmers. Insurgent Midwesterners led by George Norris revolted against the conservatives led by Speaker Cannon. The Democrats won control of the House in 1910. As the rift between insurgents and conservatives widened in 1912, Roosevelt broke with Taft and tried for a third term. He was outmaneuvered by Taft and lost the nomination. Roosevelt led his delegates out of the convention and created a new party, the Progressive, or Bull Moose, ticket in the election of 1912. Few party leaders followed him except Hiram Johnson of California. Roosevelt had the support of many notable women. Reformers, including Jane Addams. The Roosevelt caused split in the Republican vote resulted in a decisive victory for Democrat Woodrow Wilson, temporarily interrupting the Republican era. The Republicans welcomed the Progressive era at the state and local level. The first important reform mayor was Hazen S. Pingree of Detroit, 1890-1897, who was elected governor of Michigan in 1896. In New York City, the Republicans joined nonpartisan reformers to battle Tammany Hall, and elected Seth Lowe. 1902-1903 Golden Rule Jones was first elected mayor of Toledo as a Republican in 1897, but was re-elected as an independent when his party refused to renominate him. Many Republican civic leaders, following the example of Mark Hanna, were active in the National Civic Federation, which promoted urban reforms and sought to avoid wasteful strikes. TR's 1908 farewell speeches sought progressive goals but did not pass Congress. The party controlled the presidency throughout the 1920s, running on a platform of opposition to the League of Nations, high tariffs, and promotion of business interests. Warren G. Harding, Calvin Coolidge, and Herbert Hoover were resoundingly elected in 1920, 1924, and 1928 respectively. The breakaway efforts of Senator Robert La Follette in 1924 failed to stop a landslide for Coolidge, and his movement fell apart. The Teapot Dome scandal threatened to hurt the party, but Harding died and Coolidge blamed everything on him, as the opposition splintered. In 1924, the pro-business policies of the decade seemed to produce an unprecedented prosperity, until the Wall Street crash of 1929 heralded the Great Depression. Although the party did very well in large cities and among ethnic Catholics in presidential elections of 1920-1924, it was unable to hold those gains in 1928. By 1932, the cities, for the first time ever, had become Democratic strongholds. Hoover, by nature an activist, attempted to do what he could to alleviate the widespread suffering caused by the Depression, but his strict adherence to what he believed were Republican principles precluded him from establishing relief directly from the federal government. The Depression cost Hoover the presidency with the 1932 landslide election of Franklin D. Roosevelt. Roosevelt's New Deal coalition controlled American politics for most of the next three decades, excepting the two-term presidency of Republican Dwight Eisenhower. The Democrats made major gains in the 1930 midterm elections, giving them congressional parity though not control for the first time since Woodrow Wilson's presidency. Progressives and liberals. The Republican Party had a progressive element, typified in the early 20th century by Theodore Roosevelt in the 1907-1912 period. Roosevelt was more conservative at other points. Senator Robert M. La Follette Sr. and his sons in Wisconsin from about 1900 to 1946, and Western leaders such as Senator Hiram Johnson in California, Senator George W. Norris in Nebraska, Senator Bronson M. Cutting in New Mexico, Congresswoman Jeanette Rankin in Montana, and Senator William Borah in Idaho. They were generally progressive in domestic policy, supported unions, and supported much of the New Deal, but were isolationist in foreign policy. This element died out by the 1940s outside Congress. Of the leaders who supported Theodore Roosevelt in 1912, most opposed the New Deal. Starting in the 1930s, a number of Northeastern Republicans took liberal positions regarding labor unions, spending, and New Deal policies. They included Mayor Fiorello LaGuardia in New York City, Governor Thomas E. Dewey of New York, Governor Earl Warren of California, Senator Clifford P. Case of New Jersey, Henry Cabot Lodge Jr. of Massachusetts, Senator Prescott Bush of Connecticut, father and grandfather of the two Bush presidents, Senator Jacob K. Javits of New York, Governor William Scranton of Pennsylvania, and Governor George W. Romney of Michigan. The most notable of them all was Governor Nelson A. Rockefeller of New York. They generally advocated a free market, but with some level of regulation. Rockefeller required employable welfare recipients to take available available jobs or job training, while the media sometimes called them Rockefeller Republicans. The liberal Republicans never formed an organized movement or caucus, and lacked a recognized leader. They promoted economic growth and high state and federal spending, while accepting high taxes and much liberal legislation, with the proviso they could administer it more efficiently. They opposed the Democratic big city machines while welcoming support from labor unions and big business alike. Religion and social issues were not high on their agenda in foreign policy. They were internationalists, throwing their support to Dwight D. Eisenhower over the conservative leader Robert A. Taft in 1952. They were often called the Eastern Establishment by conservatives such as Barry Goldwater. The Goldwater conservatives fought this establishment from 1960. Defeated it in 1964, and eventually retired most of its members, although some became Democrats like Senator Charles Goodell and Mayor John Lindsay in New York. President Richard Nixon adopted many of their positions, especially regarding health care, welfare spending, environmentalism, and support for the arts and humanities, after Congressman John B. Anderson of Illinois bolted the party in 1980 and ran as an independent against Reagan. The liberal GOP element faded away. Their old strongholds in the Northeast are now mostly held by Democrats. Political firsts for women and minorities from its inception in 1854 to 1964, when Senate Republicans pushed hard for passage of the Civil Rights Act of 1964 against a filibuster by Senate Democrats. The GOP had a reputation for supporting blacks and minorities in 1869, the Republican-controlled legislature in Wyoming Territory and its Republican governor John Allen Campbell made it the first jurisdiction to grant voting rights to women in 1875, California swore in the first Hispanic governor, Republican Romualdo Pacheco in 1916, Jeanette Rankin of Montana became the first woman in Congress, and indeed the first woman in any high-level government position in 1928, New Mexico elected the first Hispanic U.S. Senator, Republican Octaviano Larrazolo in 1898, the first Jewish U.S. Senator elected from outside of the former Confederacy was Republican Joseph Simon of Oregon in 1924, the first Jewish woman elected to the U.S. House of Representatives was Republican Florence Kahn of California in 1928, the Republican U.S. Senate Majority Leader, Charles Curtis of Kansas, who grew up on the Kaw Indian Reservation, became the first person of significant non-European ancestry to be elected to national office. As Vice President of the United States for Herbert Hoover, blacks generally identified with the GOP until the 1930s. Every African American who served in the U.S. House of Representatives before 1935, and all of the African Americans who served in the U.S. Senate before 1979, were Republicans. Frederick Douglass after the Civil War and Booker T. Washington in the early 20th century were prominent Republican spokesmen fighting the New Deal coalition. 1932-1980 main articles, Old Right United States and Fifth Party System. Historian George H. Nash argues, unlike the moderate, internationalist, largely Eastern bloc of Republicans who accepted or at least acquiesced in some of the Roosevelt Revolution and the essential premises of President Truman's foreign policy, the Republican right at heart was counter-revolutionary, anti-collectivist, anti-communist, anti-New Deal, passionately committed to limited government, free market economics, and congressional as opposed to executive prerogatives. The GOP conservatives were obliged from the start to wage a constant two-front war against liberal Democrats from without and Me Too Republicans from within. The old right emerged in opposition to the New Deal of Franklin D. Roosevelt. Hoff says, moderate Republicans and leftover Republican progressives like Hoover composed the bulk of the old right by 1940, with a sprinkling of former members of the Farmer Labor Party, Nonpartisan League, and even a few Midwestern Prairie Socialists 1933-1938. After Roosevelt took office in 1933, New Deal legislation sailed through Congress at lightning speed in the 1934 midterm elections. 10 Republican senators went down to defeat, leaving them with only 25 against 71 Democrats. The House of Representatives was also split in a similar ratio. The Second New Deal was heavily criticized by the Republicans in Congress, who likened it to class warfare and socialism. The volume of legislation, as well as the inability of the Republicans to block it, soon made the opposition to Roosevelt develop into bitterness and sometimes hatred for that man in the White House. Former President Hoover became a leading orator crusading against the New Deal, hoping unrealistically to be nominated again for president. Most major newspaper publishers favored Republican moderate Alf Landon for president in the nation's 15 largest cities. The newspapers that editorially endorsed Landon represented 70% of the circulation, while Roosevelt won 69% of the actual voters in those cities. Ignoring the press, FDR used the radio to reach voters directly. FDR carried 46 of the 48 states thanks to traditional Democrats along with newly energized labor unions, city machines, and the WPA. The realignment creating the fifth party system was firmly in place since 1928. The GOP had lost 178 House seats, 40 Senate seats, and 19 governorships. It retained a mere 89 seats in the House and 16 in the Senate. The black vote held for Hoover in 1932, but started moving toward Roosevelt by 1940. The majority of Northern blacks were voting Democratic. Roosevelt made sure blacks had a share in relief programs, the wartime army, and wartime defense industry, but did not challenge segregation or the denial of voting rights in the South. Minority parties tend to factionalize, and after 1936 the GOP split into a conservative faction dominant in the West and Midwest and a liberal faction dominant in the Northeast, combined with a residual base of inherited progressive republicanism active throughout the century. In 1936 Kansas Governor Alf Landon and his young followers defeated the Herbert Hoover faction. Landon generally supported most New Deal programs, but carried only two states in the Roosevelt landslide with his moderate campaign. The GOP was left with only 16 senators and 88 representatives to oppose the New Deal, with Massachusetts Senator Henry Cabot Lodge Jr. as the sole victor over a Democratic incumbent. Roosevelt alienated many conservative Democrats, in 1937, by his unexpected plan to pack the Supreme Court via the Judiciary Reorganization Bill of 1937. Following a sharp recession that hit early in 1938, major strikes all over the country, the CIO and AFL competing with each other for membership, and Roosevelt's failed efforts to radically reorganize the Supreme Court, the Democrats were in disarray. Meanwhile, the GOP was united. They had shed their weakest members in a series of defeats since 1930. Re-energized Republicans focused attention on strong, fresh candidates in major states, especially Robert A. Taft, the conservative from Ohio, Earl Warren, the moderate who won both the Republicans and the Democratic primaries in California, and Thomas Dewey, the crusading prosecutor from New York. The GOP comeback in 1938 was made possible by carrying 50% of the vote outside the South, giving GOP leaders confidence it had a strong base for the 1940 presidential election. The GOP gained 75 House seats in 1938, but were still a minority. Conservative Democrats, mostly from the South, joined with Republicans led by Senator Robert A. Taft to create the Conservative Coalition, which dominated domestic issues in Congress until 1964. 1939-1952. From 1939 through 1941, there was a sharp debate within the GOP about support for Britain in World War II. Internationalists, such as Henry Stimson and Frank Knox, wanted to support Britain, and isolationists, such as Robert A. Taft and Arthur Vandenberg, strongly opposed these moves as unwise, if not unconstitutional. The America First movement was a bipartisan coalition of isolationists in 1940. A total unknown, Wendell Willkie, at the last minute, won over the party, the delegates, and was nominated. He crusaded against the inefficiencies of the New Deal and Roosevelt's break with the strong tradition against a third term. The Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor in 1941 ended the isolationist internationalist debate. The Republicans further cut the Democratic majority in the 1942 midterm elections with wartime production creating prosperity. The conservative coalition terminated most New Deal relief programs. Senator Robert A. Taft of Ohio represented the wing of the party that continued to oppose New Deal reforms and continued to champion non-interventionism. Thomas Dewey, governor of New York, represented the northeastern wing of the party. Dewey did not reject the New Deal programs, but demanded more efficiency, more support for economic growth, and less corruption. He was more willing than Taft to support Britain in 1939-1940. After the war, the isolationists' wing strenuously opposed the United Nations, and was half-hearted in opposition to World Communism as a minority party, the GOP had two wings. The left wing supported most of the New Deal while promising to run it more efficiently. The right wing opposed the New Deal from the beginning and managed to repeal large parts during the 1940s in cooperation with conservative Southern Democrats in the conservative coalition. Liberals, led by Dewey, dominated the Northeast. Conservatives, led by Taft, dominated the Midwest. The West was split, and the South was still solidly Democratic. Dewey did not reject the New Deal programs, but demanded more efficiency, more support for economic growth, and less corruption. He was more willing than Taft to support Britain in the early years of the war in 1944. A clearly frail Roosevelt defeated Dewey, who was now governor of New York, for his fourth term, but Dewey made a good showing that would lead to his selection as the candidate in 1948. Roosevelt died in April 1945, and Harry S. Truman, a less liberal Democrat, became president and replaced most of FDR's top appointees. With the end of the war, unrest among organized labor led to many strikes in 1946, and the resulting disruptions helped the GOP with the blunders of the Truman administration in 1945 and 1946. The slogans "Had Enough" and "To Err as Truman" became Republican rallying cries, and the GOP won control of Congress for the first time since 1928, with Joseph William Martin Jr. as Speaker of the House. The Taft-Hartley Act of 1947 was designed to balance the rights of management and labor. It was the central issue of many elections in industrial states in the 1940s to 1950s, but the unions were never able to repeal it in 1948. With Republicans split left and right, Truman boldly called Congress into a special session, and sent it a load of liberal legislation consistent with the Dewey platform, and dared them to act on it, knowing that the conservative Republicans would block action. Truman then attacked the Republican do-nothing Congress as a whipping boy for all of the nation's problems. Truman stunned Dewey and the Republicans in the election with a plurality of just over 2 million popular votes out of nearly 49 million cast, but a decisive 303-189 victory in the Electoral College. Eisenhower and Nixon, 1952-1974. Eisenhower and Nixon, 1953, the first Republican presidential inauguration in 24 years in 1952. Dwight D. Eisenhower, an internationalist allied with the Dewey wing, was drafted as a GOP candidate by a small group of Republicans led by Henry Cabot Lodge Jr., in order that he challenge Taft on foreign policy issues. The two men were not far apart on domestic issues. Eisenhower's victory broke a 20-year Democratic lock on the White House. Eisenhower did not try to roll back the New Deal, but he did expand the Social Security system and built the interstate highway system. After 1945, the isolationists in the conservative wing opposed the United Nations, and were half-hearted in opposition to the expansion of communism around the world. A garrison state to fight communism, they believed, would mean regimentation and government controls at home. Eisenhower, the Supreme Headquarters Allied Expeditionary Force commander, defeated Taft in 1952 on foreign policy issues. Citizens for Eisenhower to circumvent the local Republican Party apparatus mostly controlled by Taft supporters. The Eisenhower forces created a nationwide network of grassroots clubs. Citizens for Eisenhower, independents and Democrats were welcome, as the group specialized in canvassing neighborhoods and holding small group meetings. Citizens for Eisenhower hoped to revitalize the GOP by expanding its activist ranks and by supporting moderate and internationalist policies. It did not endorse candidates other than Eisenhower. However, Eisenhower paid it little attention after he won, and it failed to maintain its impressive starting momentum. Instead, the conservative Republicans became energized, leading to the Barry Goldwater nomination of 1964. Longtime Republican activists viewed the newcomers with suspicion and hostility. More significantly, activism in support of Eisenhower did not translate into enthusiasm for the party cause once in office. However, Eisenhower was not an effective party leader, and Nixon increasingly took that role. Historian David Reinhard concludes that Eisenhower lacked sustained political commitment, refused to intervene in state politics, failed to understand the political uses of presidential patronage, and overestimated his personal powers of persuasion and conciliation. Eisenhower's attempt in 1956 to convert the GOP to modern republicanism was his grandest flop. It was a vague proposal with weak staffing and little financing or publicity that caused turmoil inside the local parties across the country. The GOP carried both houses of Congress in 1952 on Ike's coattails, but in 1954 lost both and would not regain the Senate until 1980 nor the House until 1994. The problem, says Reinhard, was the voters liked Ike, but not the GOP. Nixon and Goldwater Eisenhower was an exception to most presidents in that he usually let Vice President Richard Nixon handle party affairs, controlling the National Committee and taking the roles of chief spokesman and chief fundraiser. Nixon was defeated in 1960 in a close election, weakening his moderate wing of the party. The conservatives in 1964 made a comeback under the leadership of Barry Goldwater, who defeated moderates and liberals such as Nelson Rockefeller and Henry Cabot Lodge, Jr. As the Republican candidate for the 1964 election, Goldwater was strongly opposed to the New Deal and the United Nations, but he rejected isolationism and containment, calling for an aggressive anti-communist foreign policy. In the presidential election of 1964, he was defeated by Lyndon Johnson in a landslide that brought down many senior Republican congressmen across the country. Goldwater won five states in the Deep South, the strongest showing by a Republican presidential candidate in the South since 1872. Goldwater blamed the magnitude of his defeat on the assassination of John F. Kennedy a year before the election, and on Johnson running a successful campaign. The New Deal coalition collapsed in the mid-1960s in the face of urban riots, the Vietnam War, the opposition of many Southern Democrats to desegregation and the civil rights movement, and disillusionment that the New Deal could be revived by Lyndon Johnson's Great Society. Nixon defeated both Hubert Humphrey and George C. Wallace in 1968 when the Democratic left took over their party in 1972. Nixon won re-election by carrying 49 states. Nixon's involvement in Watergate brought disgrace and a forced resignation in 1974, and any long-term movement toward the GOP was interrupted by the scandal. Gerald Ford succeeded Nixon and gave him a full pardon, thereby giving the Democrats a powerful issue they used to sweep the 1974 off-year elections. Ford never fully recovered, and in 1976 he barely defeated Ronald Reagan for the nomination. The Democrats made major gains in Congress, and the taint of Watergate and the nation's economic difficulties contributed to the election of Democrat Jimmy Carter in 1976. Running as a Washington outsider, Ronald Reagan was elected president in the 1980 election by a landslide vote, not predicted by most voter polling. Running on a peace through strength platform to combat the communist threat and massive tax cuts to revitalize the economy, Reagan's strong persona proved too much for Carter. Reagan's election also gave Republicans control of the Senate for the first time in decades, dubbed the Reagan Revolution. He fundamentally altered several long-standing debates in Washington, namely dealing with the Soviet threat and reviving the economy. His election saw the conservative wing of the party gain control while reviled by liberal opponents in his day. His proponents contend his programs provided unprecedented economic growth, and spurred the collapse of the Soviet Union. Detractors of Reagan's policies note that although Reagan promised to simultaneously slash taxes, massively increase defense spending, and balance the budget, by the time he left office the nation's budget deficit had tripled in his 8 years in office. In 2009, Reagan's budget director noted that the debt explosion has resulted not from big spending by the Democrats, but instead the Republican Party's embrace, about three decades ago, of the insidious doctrine that deficits don't matter if they result from tax cuts. He inspired conservatives to greater electoral victories by being re-elected in a landslide against Walter Mondale in 1984, but oversaw the loss of the Senate in 1986. Strength of parties in 1977. Party: Republican, Democratic, Independent. Party ID: Gallup 22%, 47%, 31%. Congressman 181,354. House 143,292. Senate 3862.